So I want to go back to Fred Pleitgen because he was the first U.S. reporter to go into the war-torn suburb of Irpin and to film it with his team and his photojournalists. It became one of the hardest hit areas since the start of the war. So, Fred, what did you and your team see?
You're absolutely right, Aaron. One of the hardest hit areas, and also, of course, the area where the Russians really tried to blast their way into the capital of Kiev, but they were confronted and held up by Ukrainian forces. Nevertheless, the place still under extreme and very intense shelling. We did manage to get in there today. It was very difficult. Let's have a look. There is no safe way to get into Irpin. The only feasible route is on the back of a police special forces pickup truck on dirt paths. But even here, the earth is scorched after Russian troops shelled the trail. Ukrainian forces are taking us into this area on back roads because they say taking the main roads is simply much too dangerous. They want to show us the damage done when Russian forces tried to enter Kiev. Ukrainian authorities say this is still one of the most dangerous places in this war-torn country. And we immediately see why. We are driving right towards an area engulfed in smoke from artillery shelling. This is where Russian forces tried to push into Ukraine's capital, but were stopped and beaten back by the underdog Ukrainians. The battles here are fierce. Authorities say 50% of the city has been destroyed. To us, that number seems like an understatement.
We have to keep moving quickly because this place can get shelled anytime.
Ukraine's national police now patrols Irpin again, but their forces frequently come under fire, the chief tells me. Just yesterday, our officers who were searching for dead bodies, they were shot at with mortars, he says. They had to lay under the bridge and wait for it to stop. But the grim task of finding and taking out the many dead continues. More than two dozen on this day alone. Some have been laying in the streets for weeks and can only now be removed. When Russian forces invaded Ukraine, they quickly advanced on the capital, Kiev, all the way to Irpin. Here, the Ukrainians stood and fought back. Vladimir Putin's army controlled large parts of Irpin, and the battle laid waste to much of this formerly wealthy suburb. And this was the epicenter where we find burned out Russian trucks and armored vehicles.
So this is the area where some of the heaviest fighting took place in Irpin. And as you can see, that there was a Russian armored vehicle which was completely annihilated. We do have to be very careful around here because there still could be unexploded munitions laying around.
We meet Volodymyr Rudenko, a local resident who says he stayed and took up arms when the Russians invaded. Always, there was not a single day when I left town, he says, even during the heaviest fighting. It must have been difficult, I ask. Just so you understand, he says, once there were 348 impacts in one area in one single hour. And the battle here is not over. Suddenly, Irpin's mayor shows up with a group of special forces saying they're looking for Russians possibly still hiding here. I ask him how it's going. We're working, he says. There's information that there are two Russian soldiers dressed in civilian clothes, but with our group, we're going to clean them up. Ukrainian forces say they will continue the fight and further push Russian forces away from their capital. The deputy interior minister saying they need the U.S.'s support to succeed.
What do you need from the United States?
Everything. Military support, first of all.
Weapons to help the Ukrainians expel the invading army, they hope, and finally bring this suburb out of the reach of Vladimir Putin's cannons.
Fred, just incredible to see that. And I'm interested, you know, you talk about the mayor showing up and they're looking for those two Russians, to his words, to clean them up with the special forces. How is the morale of the Ukrainian troops? Just seeing that destruction up close, killing people, and still having to fight in their own destroyed towns.
Yeah, having to fight in their own destroyed town and having been in that destroyed town for such a long period of time, we were really surprised to see that the morale is extremely high. And I think one of the main reasons for that is that they just feel that they had this gigantic Goliath army that was trying to, you know,
basically just punch through their defenses, and they managed to push them back. And I do think that that's something that has given them a big morale boost. I think that they've realized that they know how to fight against the Russian army. They're capable of fighting against the Russian army. But, you know, the Ukrainians have also taken some pretty big casualties, especially in that fight north of Kiev as well. And they're under no illusions that it's something that's going to go on. That fight is not over. There are still a lot of Russian forces there. And that shelling is certainly something that's pretty tough to deal with. But the morale was really, really high. And those soldiers certainly seem to be in good spirits, Aaron.
Yeah, it's incredible just to see that. I mean, that came across through your video, but also just that feeling of not knowing, right, that there could be shelling even while you're there, that there could be people hiding in buildings who are going to shoot at you. I mean, that's that level of existence. Fred, thank you so much.